Many passages from the Bible had always had great meaning for me. For example, there was Matthew 7:6. Do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and then turn and tear you to pieces. This had great meaning to me when people who I had tried to reason with simply could not appreciate my careful explanations. I realized that they simply had not reached an advanced enough level to appreciate what I was saying. Then there was Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. And Romans 1:22. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. These verses help me understand why some people rejected Christianity despite being highly educated. They also reminded me to humble myself when I thought I had a better solution than what God was offering me. I kept these verses and many verses in my heart to guide me and encourage me in times of doubt and uncertainty. However, I also realized that I had never taken up the task of reading the Bible from cover to cover. In my second year of college, about a year before I met the professor, I felt that I had finally reached the literary ability to do this. Also, after reading The Signs of God, I had a renewed vigor for learning the power of Scripture. I started in Genesis, immediately following the verses that had been validated by the science of God. These chapters were about Noah, Lot, Abraham, Jacob, and Joseph. One thing I learned that bothered me was that Abraham had asked his wife Sarah to lie to the Egyptians in Genesis. He did this because Sarah was very attractive, and Abraham was afraid that the Egyptians would kill him so they could take her. This seemed like immoral behavior in and of itself for a servant of the one true God. Why would Abraham lie when he had God on his side? The Holy Spirit had guided me to always tell the truth at all times. God would rescue me if the truth had gotten me into trouble. Telling a lie could never be right. But what was worse was that, after the Egyptians believed Sarah and took Sarah to Pharaoh as a wife, God punished Pharaoh with diseases because he had taken Abraham's wife. This seemed completely backwards to me. Shouldn't God have punished Sarah and Abraham for lying? Again, the Holy Spirit had made it clear to me through spiritual feelings that lying was always wrong. I encountered other behaviors from the God of the Old Testament that just didn't make sense. One was when Moses had asked Pharaoh to let the Hebrews leave Egypt in Exodus, and God had hardened Pharaoh's heart. Why would God do that? Didn't that violate Pharaoh's free will? Didn't that defeat the purpose of God telling Moses to ask? Didn't that just keep the Hebrews enslaved longer? Wasn't that unfair to the Egyptians too? God had killed all of their firstborn sons and inflicted them with plagues because of this. Wasn't this unfair if God was just using Pharaoh as a puppet? After trying to answer these questions for a few minutes, I decided that I just didn't understand what God was trying to do and reminded myself not to lean on my own understanding. After finishing Exodus, I moved on to Leviticus. I was dismayed to find that the book was filled almost entirely with rules about how to do sacrifices. I had known that God had told the Hebrews to make sacrifices from stories like Cain and Abel. However, I also knew that through the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus Christ, we no longer had to make sacrifices to be forgiven. What overwhelmed me was the amount of detail God had put into explaining how to do the sacrifices and offerings. One set of verses from the second chapter of Leviticus read, "When someone brings a grain of offering to the Lord, his offering is to be of fine flour. He is to pour oil in it, put incense on it, and take it to Aaron's sons, the priests. If you bring a grain of offering baked in an oven, it is to consist of fine flour, cakes made without yeast and mixed with oil, or wafers made without yeast and spread with oil. If your grain offering is prepared on a griddle, it is to be made of fine flour, mixed with oil, and without yeast. Every grain offering you bring to the Lord must be made without yeast, for you are not to burn any yeast or honey in any offering made to the Lord by fire." Why would God care about such mundane details? God had always taught me to rise above the mundane and see the bigger spiritual picture. I didn't see how these details could possibly have value for my spiritual life. After several chapters, I tired of the mundane and repetitive details in Leviticus and moved on to Numbers. Here too I found tedious details, this time about counting the numbers of Israelites that were from different tribes. After that, it returned to offerings and sacrifices, like Leviticus. I skipped to Deuteronomy and found more tedious law codes. All of these rules and laws were antithetical to the idea that God's law was written on our hearts, as explained by Paul in Romans. For when Gentiles, who do not have the law, by nature do the things in the law, these, although not having the law, are a law to themselves, who show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness. When I had started reading the Bible from cover to cover, I expected to see the lessons of the Holy Spirit that had been taught to me confirmed through Scripture. Instead, I was finding the Old Testament to be, at best, almost completely unrelated to them, and at worst, antithetical to them. But then I thought, maybe all these numbers and seemingly tedious and meaningless commandments had some kind of pattern that could be connected to science by someone like Gerald Schroeder. Or maybe they showed how difficult it was to serve God before Jesus had made his sacrifice and changed everything. I felt that maybe the Holy Spirit was directing me to read the New Testament. I'd spent a lot of time studying Acts and the epistles. One of my favorite verses was from Acts 1:18, with the reward he got for his wickedness. Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong. His body burst open, and all his intestines spilled out. While it was violent and horrible, the greed and total lack of remorse that he expressed in the passage showed that Judas deserved this death. The Holy Spirit had given me an image of his death, of Judas walking into the field, then falling forward suddenly, his intestines gruesomely exploding from his abdomen. This was evidence of God's justice and palpable wrath against the wicked. Judas had thought he had gotten away, but God had tangibly and forcefully struck him down. While I'd spent much time reading the red letter quotes of Jesus in the Gospels, I'd never read the story for myself. Of course, I knew the story, but I'd never followed the details. So this is where my next journey in the Bible took me. After a few evenings of reading, I finally reached the end of Matthew, where Judas betrayed Jesus. I looked forward to reading Matthew's account of God's wrath against the wicked and remorseless Judas. I finally reached the point where I expected that to happen, in Matthew 27:5. So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hanged himself. My tongue caught in the back of my throat. My chest seized up, adrenaline rushed through my body, and my heart pounded. It felt as if the very fabric of reality itself was tearing apart. It felt like the paint on the wall surrounding me would tear open to reveal an empty darkness. Everything I had believed laid vulnerable on an altar, waiting to be pierced, waiting to be sacrificed to this horrifying moment of realization. This Judas was not remorseless. This Judas seemed filled with guilt. So filled with guilt, in fact, that he hung himself. God had exercised no wrath against him. He had felt so guilty that he hung himself. I panicked. I turned back to the verse in Acts, then back to the verse in Matthew. I braced myself to face the consequence that my entire religion was a mistake. For 4 hours, I let the verses occupy an uncomfortable residence in the back of my mind. I tried to go about my day. I tried not to think about them. But eventually, I couldn't take the cognitive dissonance any longer, and I turned to the internet. I found an apologist's explanation and held my breath. Judas, they explained, had hung himself in the field, and then his intestines had fallen out after he had decomposed. It made sense, I guess. Maybe I'd just been wrong. It still didn't explain the feelings I'd been given by the Holy Spirit about Judas being remorseless in Acts, and the sense that he had been completely remorseful in Matthew, or that God had expressed his palpable wrath in Acts, and had been completely absent during Judas's death in Matthew. But then again, maybe I'd just been wrong. Even though I had at least tentatively accepted the apologist's explanation, my faith in the Bible as a clear and simple source of truth had been shattered. While I continued to have faith in the Bible, I never looked at it quite the same way again. In the back of my mind, I had slowly started to realize that, at best, the Bible was something that required very complicated explanations and intense research to understand. And at worst, it was the fallible word of men who may have written it to fit their own purposes, or at least made some serious mistakes. After this experience, the Bible was no longer the clear word of God that flowed straight from his mind to mine. It suddenly required the intervention of outside sources to rescue it from being misunderstood. It could no longer stand on its own. I still had faith in the Bible. I just couldn't look at it the same way anymore.